Greetings. Greetings around the world. My name is Tom Banchoff. I serve as Vice President for Global Engagement at Georgetown University, and I'm delighted to welcome you to our virtual dialogue on a fascinating and timely topic, New Chinese Approaches to Humanities Education. This event is sponsored by the China Forum for Civilizational Dialogue, a collaboration between Georgetown University and La Civita Cattolica, two Jesuit institutions, one in Washington, D.C., and one in Rome, both committed to intercultural and interreligious dialogue for the common good. So the Jesuits, also known as the Society of Jesus, are an order of priests, of course, within the Catholic Church with a long history of engagement with China, going back to the 16th century. One of the earliest and most famous Jesuit missionaries, Father Matteo Ricci, lived and worked in China, developing a model of intercultural encounter that combined a strong commitment to one's own beliefs and values with a readiness to engage in dialogue with others in service to the common good. It's proven a productive model, one especially relevant today at a time of great political and ideological polarization on a global scale. So the China Forum is very much in the Ricci tradition. Through academic seminars, public events, and an online platform, Georgetown and La Civita Cattolica, a leading Catholic journal with roots deep in the 19th century, bring Chinese thinkers together with international partners to discuss common challenges at the intersection of culture, ethics, and global society. In this connection, I'm very happy to note that today marks the one-year anniversary of the first publication of the Chinese language edition of La Civita Cattolica, so a great contemporary example of cultural opening and dialogue. Now, our topic today, as you know, is the future of humanities education, a major concern shared across our societies, given the increasing pressures on our universities to educate students narrowly for the marketplace. And we brought together a panel of experts to discuss innovative Chinese efforts within the higher education sector over the past couple of decades to strengthen humanities education. And we're going to have the opportunity for a discussion of those developments from a global and comparative perspective. I'd now like to turn things over to my friend and colleague, Daniel Bell, who will more fully introduce our topic and our panelists. Daniel is Dean of the School of Political Science and Public Administration at Shandong University in Qingdao. A well-known public intellectual and prolific writer, he's published many thoughtful and provocative works, including Just Hierarchy, Why Social Hierarchies Matter in China and the Rest of the World, The China Model, and another influential book on China's new Confucianism. And I think especially relevant for our conversation today, Daniel is also the founding editor of a Princeton University Press series that translates original works by Chinese scholars across disciplines into English. So Daniel, thanks so much for leading our conversation today, and let me hand it over to you.
Thank you, Tom. It's a great honor to be part of this dialogue, which I think is needed more than ever, especially when at the very highest levels of government, there are not so friendly ties. But among us, even though we have diverse perspectives and we're from different parts of the world, I think we share a commitment to, well, to truth and the common good, for lack of a better language. One of the fascinating developments in China over the past two or three decades is the revival of the humanities. And it's one of the few places in the world where there's much, much more interest and actually funding for the humanities. Of course, we know that's also accompanied by censorship, which is obviously something that intellectuals are not in favor of. But nonetheless, I mean, even I see it as a dean myself. I have, you know, there's lots of resources to hire people in the humanities, which is quite exceptional. I think in many other countries, the trend is more or less the other way around. Now, what explains this revival of the humanities in China especially? And what are its main contours and variants? What are the problems with it also, of course? What are the challenges that we face here in China? And maybe what are the things that we're doing well and that maybe could be offered to the rest of the world as a kind of positive experience? I mean, I think these questions are fascinating, and we have a great cast of, well, professors to discuss these questions from different perspective. So I'll go through the list of participants briefly, and then we can go right on to our dialogue. One of the participants, I guess it's in somewhat alphabetical order, is Benoit Vermander. He's a professor of religious studies in the Department of Philosophy at Fudan University. He heads the Xu Ruiqi Dialogue Institute, and he has published extensively on Chinese religions and interreligious encounters in East Asia. His publications include Shanghai Sacred, Corporate Social Responsibility in China, and Light in the Night, Art, Life, Philosophy. I should say that Benoit is also an accomplished painter, a real unbelievable, Renaissance person, we might say, although I'm not sure what the equivalent, well, a Jinza maybe in a Chinese context. Anyway, the next person, the next professor we have is Catherine Temple. She is a professor in the Department of English at Georgetown University, where she has taught since 1994, and she specializes in the study of law and the humanities. Among her many publications are Loving Justice, Legal Emotions in William Blackstone's England, and the co-edited Research Handbook on Law and Emotions. Also quite fascinating, she does humanities outreach activities, including work with military veterans and the incarcerated. It's a very practical work as well. Another speaker we have is a professor at Peking University, which arguably is one of the, I think that Fudan University and Peking University are the two leading universities in China that are at the very forefront of the revival of the humanities. It hurts me to say this because I'm a Shandong University. We're nearly there, but I do admit that Peking University and Fudan are very much at the top. And Professor Xiang Shuchen is an assistant professor of philosophy in the Department of Philosophy and Religious Studies, and also at the Institute of Foreign Philosophy at Peking University. She was born in China and educated in the UK from the age of 7. And she received her undergraduate education from the University of Cambridge and her PhD in philosophy, jointly from the Humboldt Universität in Berlin and King's College London. And I'm not sure if I should say this, but she currently has a manuscript under consideration by Princeton University Press. She'll be very, very well known soon. I can firmly predict that. It's a great manuscript. And we have Professor Bai Tongdong, who is an old friend. He's also a Dongfang Chair Professor of Philosophy at Fudan University and Global Professor of Law at NYU Law School. Among his books, well, his most recent book is called Against Political Equality, The Confucian Case by Princeton University Press. A great book, a very systematic and controversial, a great read as well. Strongly recommend it. And he's also directs an English language master's in Chinese philosophy at Fudan University. And you just heard from Thomas Banchoff, who's a vice president for global engagement at Georgetown University and professor in the Department of Government and the Walsh School of Foreign Service. He serves as a senior fellow in Georgetown's Berkeley Center for Religion, Peace, and World Affairs, which he has led as founding director from 2006 to 2017. His scholarship centers on ethical and religious issues in world politics. And to me, he's a kind of model because he's both a great political theorist and a great administrator. And I think I aspire to be both of those, still have a long way to go. Now, what we're gonna do today is we're going to start with Professor Xiang Shuchen, who will speak for 10 minutes. Then we'll have Professor Bai Tongdong speak for 10 minutes. And then we will have a 5-minute comment / critique by Professor Temple, then another comment / critique by Professor Vermander, and then I will talk for 5 minutes. Then we'll have a 20-minute exchange between the panelists, and then from 10:30 to, till the end, from 10 to 10:30, we'll have the Q&A with the people in the audience. And we should end around 10:30. It's possible that Professor Wang Hui, who unfortunately had an obligation at Tsinghua, which is ends at 9:30 p.m. He might join us, but I can't promise that he will. So why don't we start right away? We're ahead of schedule. Great. Let's start with Professor Xiang Shuchen, please, for 10 minutes.
Okay, great. So lovely to be joining everybody. So what I will talk about today is, I'll first of all talk about my undergraduate education, general education, to kind of give the audience some kind of context of where I'm coming from, where my perspective is coming from. And then I'll talk about the undergraduate curriculum in philosophy at Peking University, which I think is probably representative of humanity, of philosophy education in China broadly. And then lastly, I will go on to offer my thoughts on how philosophy education in China could possibly change in order to stay relevant. And then my thoughts on humanities a bit in the West as well. Okay, so first of all, let me just give a bit more context about myself so that I contextualize some of my perspectives. So like Daniel said, I grew up in China, but then from the age of 7 onwards, I was educated in the UK. So I have my undergrad from Cambridge. First of all, in architecture, but then I switched to the more kind of strictly humanities education. I have a master's degree from Warwick University in English literature. And then I was on the PhD program in comparative literature at Penn State University in the United States. And then I went to the University of Hawaii and got a master's degree in philosophy, in comparative philosophy. And then I finally received my PhD in philosophy from the Humboldt in Germany and King's College London. And I've also stayed quite extensively in Singapore as well, because my partner did his education there. So I have some ideas of how their education is structured as well. Okay, so now I want to just show everybody, and I'll share the screen. I want to share everybody the structure of the undergraduate curriculum for philosophy at Peking University. So I'm gonna go ahead and share screen now. So the structure of the undergrad curriculum goes like this. It was established in 1914 and is a 4-year program. And the students have to do 132 credits, and this is split between 4 areas. There's a thing which I translated as a cross-disciplinary core foundational classes. And that's basically classes that all the humanities students have to take. So it's shared across the humanities. And then the philosophy students do get to do their own philosophy classes. That's the core classes which they have to take. But then they also get to take some elective classes. You know, they get to choose what they want to do as well. And then finally, there's some further general education classes and then independent elective courses. So now I'm going to go ahead and show you the kind of classes that they do in each of these 4 subsets. Okay, so in that first section, which is that cross-disciplinary core foundation class, which all the humanities students have to take, you can see that there's English language, modern Chinese history, Marxism, of course, either advanced mathematics, classical Chinese, philology, reading the classics, more history, and then archaeology, world history, social thought, and methodology, so foreign sociological theories. So it's quite a broad span, in my opinion. Okay, and then when the students within philosophy themselves, within the philosophy department themselves, they have to take these core classes. So they have to take Introduction to Philosophy, and then philosophy from Chinese philosophy, Western philosophy, Introduction to Religion, Logic and Argument, Ethics, Aesthetics, Philosophy of Science. And this is the, reflects, this structure reflects the sections of the philosophy department in PKU itself. So the philosophy department at PKU, it's at Peking University, has this much diversity. There is Chinese philosophy section, religious studies section, logic section, ethics section, aesthetic section, and so forth. Okay. And then, so the core class, so I've explained the core classes they have to take, and then they get to take some elective classes. And then the elective classes are also split into the sections that reflect the diversity of the philosophy department as a whole. So you have, you can take classes in Marxist philosophy, Chinese philosophy, foreign philosophy. So I'm in the section for foreign philosophy, et cetera, et cetera. So if you can, so in this next slide, I'm just gonna skip between this. So if you see the first section is foundation classes in philosophy. This is the list of classes you can take in foundation classes in philosophy. Now, if I just skip back, you see the classes in Marxist philosophy, and I'm gonna keep doing this. So Marxist philosophy, this is all the classes you can take in Marxist philosophy. So let me just go ahead and go through that a little bit. So Marxist philosophy, Deng Xiaoping's thought, Marxist philology, etc. And in the Chinese philosophy electives, it's histories of Chinese philosophy, I Ching, discussion of classical philology, modern Chinese philosophy, etc. And then the biggest section is foreign philosophy, which actually includes, I think, something that's quite counterintuitive to maybe a Western philosophy department, philosophies, Indian, as well as Korean, Japanese philosophy, Arabic philosophy, all of these are kind of lumped into the same section. So Russian philosophy as well. And then the more kind of typical subjects like phenomenology, Kant, all of those, Plato. And then so logic, religion, aesthetics, ethics, all of these you have your own elective classes to choose from. And then finally, we have that section on the general education and independent elective courses. So that's, you can take more further elective courses from your own major, and then there's more general courses to take from the math department or the natural science department, social science department, psychology department, history department, art department, etc. And this is, so we won't have time to go through it, but this is they actually have a table of all the classes you can take from these various departments as part of your general education. Okay, and then the general education was, I think, broadly, I would think, inspired by the kind of Western ideas of liberal arts, because the description that I found basically talks about the general education, these kind of liberal arts terms about cultivating personhood, civic awareness, which sounds very, liberal arts to me. Okay, so I'm going to stop sharing there. And then just finally, in the last few moments that I have, talk a bit about my thoughts about this undergraduate curriculum. And then philosophy in the UK, philosophy in the West, and then also in China. So I think, as you've seen, I think the PKU undergraduate philosophy curriculum is very, very diverse, both internal to the philosophy curriculum itself, so the classes they take from philosophy, but then also the fact that they have to take a lot of these more humanistic general education classes. It reflects a lot of diversity, and I haven't in my experience seen that kind of diversity from a philosophy student curriculum in the institutions in English speaking countries that I've visited or in Germany. So I think that's kind of, and I think that's both a pro and a con for the philosophy department. It's great to be diverse, but maybe it's also lacks a little orientation. So it's arguable. And then, so finally, my own kind of experience of having been in philosophy for the time that I have is that, I think that philosophy in the West, I hope it's not too controversial to say this, has something of an identity crisis. Philosophy is not what it used to be in the days of Kant, when it was just so relevant and everybody read philosophers. And I think that for slightly different reasons, philosophy also has an identity crisis in China, more for the reasons that it's hard to know what the identity of Chinese philosophy should be. How does it fit in within the wider international understanding of philosophy? And so the way that, for me, it seems the way that philosophy needs to be become relevant in China has a more unique set of challenges than a different, slightly different set of challenges than it has in Western countries, because due to the Western's own historical reasons, they have, there's a particular reason why philosophy has now become a slightly out of touch. But the reasons are in China for philosophy's self-identity, self-identity crisis is slightly different. Okay, so I think I'm on time.
Yes, thank you. That was a beautiful introduction for a account of your experience at Peking University, and very helpful. When the discussion period, we can ask how typical that, how many professors at Peking University in philosophy, just to give a sense of how big the department is?
Like 60?
Yeah, six zero, right? Yeah, so yeah. It's huge. I mean, that's one thing that's worth noting compared to the philosophy departments in the West and elsewhere. Okay, thank you so much. Let's have Professor Bai Tongdong, please.
So this the outline on my talk, and so people can have a sense of what I'm doing. And I'm asked to pay special attention to the Confucian revival and education with regard to the kind of, not just Confucian, but you know, Chinese traditional education in general, in particular in universities. So first, some little bit background. So you know, we Chinese thought we were the center of the world for for thousands of years, and we were the exporter of all sorts of values and technologies. And then, you know, around 1840, we were defeated by the British in the Opium War, and you know, very few Chinese realize that this time, you know, maybe there's a we Chinese should learn from the invaders. I mean, before we were defeated by the nomads, but you know, we thought that you know, really they only have strong horses. So there's, other than that, there's little for us to learn. But this time, very few people realize that actually this time is different. So you know, after the defeat, there was this self-strengthening movement, namely to learn from the West with regard to science and technology. And 50 years later, instead of defeating the British, we were defeated by the Japanese. And in the Sino-Japanese War around 1894. And after that, there was this so-called 100-day reform. And it's a political reform. The idea is to learn from the West, in addition to science and technology, also political and social institutions. And my alma mater, actually, where Professor Xiang is teaching now, Peking University was founded in 1898 as a result of these reforms, the first modern, by modern I mean Western, so first Western style university in China, you know, as a reaction to this defeat. But you know, it didn't work out very well, and the last dynasty collapsed, and then there are quite a few movements, the new cultural movement, and then the May 4th movement, and after the founding of the People's Republic of China, the Cultural Revolution. I mean, in spite of the subtle differences, I think all these movements are based on kind of radical and comprehensive Westernization. So I think I only need to say a little bit more about the Cultural Revolution under Chairman Mao. You know, we think it's you know, under a communist regime. So why do I say it's a Western Westernization? Because you know, the communism is not in the Chinese tradition, it came from the West, you know, slightly east in the West, but still from the West. And the Cultural Revolution is both against Chinese traditions, that's in line with the new cultural movement, the May 4th movement, but also against one version of the West, the capitalist West. But the basis to challenge that version, the capitalist West, is just another Western ideology, communism. And I think related to our topic, you know, universities were closed down during the first few years of Cultural Revolution. Then, of course, you know, Mao died, and there is this reform and open door period. And I think in this period, some fundamental myth that prevent Chinese from looking at our traditions in a benevolent way, in a charitable way. I think two myths are debunked. The first myth is, I call it the Weberian thesis, you know, attributed to Max Weber, the German sociologist. The idea is that you know, capitalist development is rooted in Protestantism, a version of Christianity. And by implication, Confucianism, the leading thought in East Asia, is an obstacle to economic development and capitalistic development. But then in the 60s, 70s, and 80s, 90s, in the last century, there was this economic rise of East Asia. And East Asian countries other than China were still deeply rooted in Confucianism. If they could develop so well economically, then the Weberian thesis has to be wrong. So that's the first debunking. The second debunking is the democratization in East Asia. We know the Harvard theorist Samuel Huntington had this famous thesis, there's this clash of civilizations, the Western civilization and the rest, right? And so since East Asia is dominated by Confucianism, which is different from the Western cultures, then there's this incoming and inevitable clash of civilizations. But then if East Asian countries, Japan, South Korea, if they can become democratic, what's the basis of this clash of civilization? And of course, finally, there is even a stronger thesis, namely, maybe there's something good about the East Asian models, including the China model. So the Chinese traditions are not only an obstacle to development, actually, they're good for development. They explain why China and East Asia have developed so much faster than much of the rest of the world. But that's a controversial thesis. And then, there's this tug of war going on about the China model. On the one hand, there's this persistent bias from both the Western and Chinese liberals. By liberals, I mean really in China, Chinese liberals, they are just pro-Western thinkers and intellectuals. They're not necessarily liberals in the Western sense. And so there is a persistent bias against Chinese traditions from both Western and Chinese liberals and from the oligarchs, the Marxist, Maoist oligarchs. And so for them, the revival of humanities or humanities education should be a revival of either a kind of Western liberal arts style humanities education or the old style Marxist Maoist ideology education. By the way, as I said, in the Cultural Revolution, universities closed down. After Deng Xiaoping took power, universities opened again. And but then at the beginning, the focus was really engineering and science. And actually, it's an interesting phenomenon in China that a lot of rich business people pay. Now they're successful. They pay people like me to have courses on traditional Chinese learning or even Western classics. So in a way, they are making up their lack of a liberal arts education when they were in college. Now they're rich, they have nothing to do, so they decide to study philosophy, both Chinese and Western. But in this vein, some people still think that we should do mostly the Western style liberal arts education. Now, the backward, traditional Chinese classics. And then, you know, in term, but of course, there is this revival of traditional education or education in Chinese classics. And, you know, in the West, it's often reported that the reason for this revival is governmental manipulation. You know, the Chinese government tries to find a new source of legitimacy through the kind of nationalist curriculum. I think there's some truth to it, but I think it's a kind of one-sided a picture, because to me, you know, after Mao died, after Maoism, became bankrupt among many Chinese, there is this cultural vacuum, right? You know, a lot of honor Chinese, they want to find some kind of belonging. And now China is doing pretty well in the economy and other aspects. Then they think maybe, you know, there's, you know, our traditions are not that bad. Otherwise, how could we do so well? So I think, you know, honor Chinese scholars and politicians, there is a genuine a calling from all of them to go back to traditions. I mean, including, you know, politicians, some of the politicians. I think it's not merely a manipulation. They truly believe that we should go back to our traditions. But in this attempt to go back to traditions, you know, there's this struggle in China with regard to curriculum design. I think especially in the past few years, it becomes stronger and stronger that, university education, the Minister of Education demands that Chinese universities reinforce ideological education, you know, Marxist, Maoist education in universities. But then at the same time, because of this kind of sort of genuine revival of traditions, there is also this emphasis by, you know, university professors like me on, kind of a humanities education in classics, both Chinese and Western. And I think there's also this tug of war going on in the world. You know, on one hand, we have people who are saying that there is going to be a new Cold War between, you know, Western values and the value of the People's Republic of China. And I think, you know, what the Ministry of Education is doing is partly responsible for that picture, because they are reinforcing this kind of all-guard, Marxist, Maoist education, which is sharply different and in, I think, very fundamental conflict with the Western style education and models. And so that's one possibility. But the another possibility is that maybe, the kind of possibility I hope to promote is not a Cold War, but a healthy competition among different
okay.
Values. Just maybe 3 seconds, I'll just stop. And yeah. Finally, with regard to the kind of education I want to promote, education in classics, both Chinese and Western, I think that, in order to promote that, we need to debunk another myth in the Western style liberal education, idea of critical thinking. The idea of critical thinking is often considered equivalent to encouraging students to speak up, to think for themselves. But to me, maybe reading the so-called that white man's books, or maybe that yellow man's books, that's the best way of critical thinking, to understand the thinking that is so different from us, both geographically and historically, temporally. I think that's probably the best way for us to see things from different perspectives. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much for your stimulating thoughts. My role here as moderator is more to facilitate the debate, but maybe I could just raise a couple of questions for the discussion period. When Professor Xiang posted the syllabus from Peking University, there was one line that mentioned about becoming excellent talents of society. I think this idea of kind of cultivating an intellectual elite and also a political elite is very much central to Chinese culture, arguably political culture. And far from feeling embarrassed about it, I think it's viewed as a central task of the university. I wonder if that helps to explain partly the revival of humanities, because there's a realization that to be a leader in society, you also need to have humanities education, not just the humanities, not just an education in, let's say as an engineer or the hard sciences. That's just a question to throw out. Also, it's worth noting that, I mean, it wasn't really emphasized in the presentations that much of philosophy, I mean, it was mentioned, but let me just elaborate, is taught outside the philosophy department. So even though you have huge philosophy departments at Fudan, how many professors do you have at Tongdong?
About 60, a little bit more 60 than 60.
Also, right. Yeah. I mean, it's huge. And a lot of it is taught in other departments too. For example, I teach in political science and public administration, and we have many philosophy-related courses here as well. So it's really this wide-ranging revival is quite fascinating. And again, it's worth asking to what extent it's particular to China or to what extent other countries have a similar phenomenon. I think it's interesting what Tongdong said about critical thinking as well, that it's not just, it's really through, again, maybe this is more of a kind of part of Chinese culture, that you first try to understand something before you criticize it. And I think that's probably, and you understand through reading the great works. That's really, of course, you have a similar idea in the US as well, but arguably it's more central in Chinese culture. This is just something to throw out for discussion. Finally, to Professor Xiang, I'm not so clear what you mean by a crisis of an identity crisis in Western philosophy and also in Chinese philosophy. I mean, what does that mean, identity crisis? I mean, I think we all have some sort of identity crisis, but maybe it sounds really bad or worrisome. Could you explain what you mean by that in Western philosophy and also what you mean by that in Chinese philosophy and how you think there might be a way out of that crisis? But now let's move on to the comments and criticisms. And we lead with Professor Catherine Temple, please, for 5 minutes.
Okay, thank you. First of all, I just want to thank the panelists and also Professor Banchoff for spurring this discussion. It's just fascinating to me. My daughter studied in China in Kunming, was a Chinese major at Georgetown. So I do feel, you know, some connections. I've lectured a couple of times in China, in English, of course, and I'm just fascinated by the educational culture. So this is not so much a critique as a sort of effort to enlarge the conversation, to think a little bit more about the student perspective. Because, you know, one of the things we discovered at Georgetown when we started talking very seriously about the value, the meaning, the history of the humanities, was that many of the students were humanities majors and were very proficient in a humanities area such as philosophy or English literature. They really could not articulate the value. They knew nothing about the history. They had a very vague idea about what the meaning of the humanities was. So about 10 years ago, we started working very seriously on this issue through a large Mellon grant. And it's resulted in a new humanities initiative from the college and also a master's program in public and engaged humanities that I'm directing. So we've had some time to really think about this. And I'm wondering as well, you know, to what extent do Chinese students, how are they helped to think about, you know, reflect upon the larger value of their education in the humanities and also to articulate these values to the public? Because we as humanities faculty can articulate them endlessly, right? Mostly to ourselves, right? But our students go out into all sorts of arenas across the world. And if they can articulate the value of the humanities in a more specific, particularized and sort of communicative way, I think that they are really our best ambassadors for the values that we advocate for. So one thing we did was, through working with graduate students, really tried to identify, what is it that the humanities values? And when we do this, we're not so much interested in saying we are the only people who teach these values, right? Because humanities folks, we always say that we teach critical thinking. But of course, the sciences teach critical thinking as well, right? So we wanted to think a little bit harder about, what exactly we were trying to convey. So some of the things that we came up with over the past maybe 10 years, but first one is a real sort of development of more comfort with intellectual and emotional difficulty. And I don't know if you've had this experience, but I certainly have with a student who says, I don't want to be a humanities major because I want to know the answers to problems, right? And they will go into the sciences sort of naively thinking that science has the answers that they're looking for, right? But that's because they have not developed this comfort with intellectual openness and with ambiguity. A value for interdisciplinarity, very important in the humanities in the US, and I'd love to hear that, how that plays out in China. Sensitivity to history, right? To the history of any problem, and that's actually quite different than in the sciences where there's a great interest in advancing knowledge, but maybe not so much interest in the history of science, right? Sensitivity to the relationship between form and content, very important, especially in literary studies, but also in foreign languages, translation studies, even in philosophy, I think. The management of multiple levels of discourse. Okay, so this is just greatly valued in the humanities, that you can move from fiction to philosophy to maybe speaking in a public register, right, with great facility. Curiosity, and this could be seen almost as critique, right? How could this idea be complicated? And that usually means sort of, what are we missing here? What are the unintended consequences? Big question in philosophy, of course, of whatever it is that we're actually doing. And that's related to seeing received truths as maybes and suggesting alternatives, right? I think the other thing that tends to divide the humanities from, say, the sciences or from mathematics is a real value placed on human subjectivity, right? So instead of seeing human subjectivity as a problem or something to be eliminated, there's a value in understanding human subjectivity. And that's what I think some of the, earlier speakers have referenced, this value in understanding the other. And then finally, at least in literary studies and probably in other areas of the humanities as well, the value of narrative. Narratives matter. Subjective telling of stories matter. So, of course, we're advocating critical thinking skills, reading and writing skills, research skills, all of those things. But these other things are more like habits of mind, ways of thinking that we develop when we seriously study the humanities. And that's, my sort of request maybe that we think throughout the rest of the time we're together a little bit about how we are educating the students to have a kind of reflective perspective on their education. So thank you.
Thank you, Catherine. That's very helpful. I wonder if we want to add one thing that separates the humanities from the sciences is a political mission, a commitment to help the marginalized, the oppressed, those who lack power. I mean, obviously scientists may not have that mission, but I wonder if we do in the humanities. It's just a question maybe we can throw out for discussion. Mm-hmm. Thank you. And now let's have Benoit, please, 5 minutes.
Sure. Hello, everyone, and thanks to the panelists. So I would say maybe for a start that my 12-year experience of teaching in a Chinese university makes me maybe a little more skeptical than what we have heard till now, not at all on the quality or the diversity of humanities education in China, but rather on the inspiration that prevails when it comes to both teaching and learning so-called humanistic studies. I'd like to start with a quotation from the Indian Spanish theologian Raymond Panikkar. He says, dialogue seeks truth by trusting the other, just as dialectics pursues truth by trusting the order of seeing, the value of reason and weighty arguments. Dialectics is the optimism of reason. Dialogue is the optimism of the heart. Dialogue does not seem primarily to be a duologue, a duet of two logoi, but a piercing of the logos to attain a truth that transcends it. I continue to see much more optimism of reason among Chinese students and teachers alike, and little optimism of the heart. Chinese students have been trained in high school, are still trained during their tertiary studies, to debate and not to dialogue. The capacity to engage into genuine dialogue being the real result of a humanistic education. They know how to show intellectual muscles. They know how to object and to criticize, to oppose right and wrong. But they know little about the art of listening or even the art of reading as a capacity to show intellectual empathy. They have little appreciation of the fact that humanistic education, that the art of dialogue, is a risky endeavor in which one's beliefs and presuppositions may be challenged to the core. Well, frankly speaking, I'm not certain that the American or the Western university system is doing better on this side. In both cases, this is partly the result of a tendency that may have been inscribed from the start into the logic of the 19th century of functioning of the academia. And it does not reflect the best of the Chinese intellectual tradition. Let us listen to the sinologist Donald Holtzman. It is in the discussion of particular facts of human existence that Confucius, and after him the philosophers in the conversational tradition, produced their particular insight, short, incisive stabs into the human condition. The form of the conversation is not an archaism. The fumbling attempt of the first Chinese philosophers to put their ideas pêle-mêle into some sort of order, but is an integral part of Confucius' thought and indeed an important clue to the character of Chinese thought in general. Still, I will not bet to plead for the emergence of the specific Chinese system of humanistic studies. I am not sure at all that such system exists or should exist. And I will say the same for the West. I would rather plead for a global humanistic educational model to engage into the task of gathering and comparing resources coming from different traditions and to reinterpret them in relationship to the global issues that shape the future of humankind. Attempting to define fields and ways of proceeding for the Jesuit intellectual apostolate today, the then Superior General of Society, Adolfo Nicolas, was writing, "Our societies today are faced with radical challenges. What does being human mean today? How can we live with religious, spiritual, and confessional diversity in cultures often marked by secularization or by fundamentalism? How can the people of the world live together in justice and with mutual respect? How do we live on Earth with limited natural resources?" The flexibility and openness of the set of questions raised here may come from its anchorage into its first subject of investigation. What does being human mean today? Few people will doubt that in various ways, our traditions have dealt primarily with precisely this topic. it seems possible to distinguish three sets of challenges that give it specific dimensions to the above mentioned question.
It's great, great, fascinating, but I wonder if you could summarize in 1 minute or conclude.
Yes, please. I can. the above question could be asked through three questions: contribution to an integral cosmology, contribution to an integral anthropology, and contribution to social cohesion process. In my view, be it in China or elsewhere, the future of humanistic education lies in its capacity at nurturing the skills through which a global dialogue on such challenges and tasks will be meaningfully and successfully conducted. And sorry if I have been too long.
Oh, thank you. Great questions and issues for us to pursue. One little comment before we open to panelists. I just wonder if the critique of Chinese students as focusing too much on, let's say, showing off their brilliance, on intellectual muscle, rather than manifesting the art of listening and showing empathy. I just wonder if that's more typical, perhaps, of two universities. In fact, the two universities that are represented here, Peking University and Fudan University, where the students are arguably, you know, less modest than at other universities. I'm at Shandong University, where I am. As you know, Shandong is the heart of Confucian culture, and the students pride themselves on hao shui, on their love of study. And I find, you know, having taught elsewhere too, that they're very good listeners, and perhaps they've imbibed this kind of Confucian ethic of understanding before, you know, showing off and so on. More than universities, other universities on this panel. But maybe this is just a view that may not be correct. But why don't we, and again, now we have some time for discussion among us.
Just a little joke. I noticed sure. You haven't mentioned Tsinghua.
It's a university that focuses mainly on the sciences, and there's a revival of the humanities and the philosophy, but it's still quite marginal compared to the overall mission of the university. But we can discuss that one too. I agree that each university has its own kind of ethos in China. It's quite remarkable. Now, why don't we ask Professor, we'll have 15 minutes or so or more, a little bit more, for discussion among ourselves. Why don't we have Professor, Shu Chen, why don't you respond to some of these issues, and then we'll have Tong Dong and then others.
So maybe I can respond to that question you were asking me earlier about the identity crisis in philosophy in West. So I meant in philosophy, there's this big split between what's known as continental philosophy and analytic philosophy. And the two parties, if you're very partisan to one side, you hate the other, and they don't refuse to talk to each other. And I think that kind of division was very famously canonically summarized by this British intellectual called C.P. Snow, and into the what's called the two cultures. And I think that this split actually reflects the varying conceptions of what philosophy should be. The analytic philosophers, I think, more generally think that they think philosophy should be more like a science. And I think the continental philosophers would think that philosophy should deal with questions that can't be sort of proven or tackled in the same way as the sciences. So I think that that's actually a very big division in philosophy. And so that affects how philosophy thinks of itself. And then I think that more so leads to this kind of specialization between, the continental philosophers will just focus on doing their own work. So like, for example, Heideggerian, they'll just go more and more into like the special kind of technicalities of Heidegger's philosophy. And they only talk among each other, and they publish papers that, you know, very few people will, only their peers will read. And it's the same for analytic philosophy. And I think that, so So that was kind of what I was thinking about. And then also quite a big issue for philosophy, I don't know if other philosophers would agree, is that I think that the status of non-Western philosophy is a very big, poses a question to what the identity of philosophy is. You know, it kind of poses a challenge to the kind of universalistic conception of philosophy and how you're supposed to deal with other people saying, oh, look, we also have philosophy, but it looks very, very different from the kind of philosophy you have. And then I don't think that that's, people have very, within philosophy, people have very different ideas of whether, you know, non-Western philosophy counts as philosophy, and that's a big source of division as well.
Okay, and what did you mean by Chinese identity crisis?
The term philosophy in China is Zhexue, and traditionally in China you wouldn't have had the kind of conception of philosophy as an academic discipline where you study the works of particular philosophers, and the idea of philosophy as ever progressing discipline in that sense. You had obviously people, you know, what we call philosophers today, like Confucius, etc., they were studied, but they were thought of as moral leaders, intellectuals, or kind of very sage-like people whose thought you studied in order to just sort of for public governance, etc., and you wouldn't have had the conception of philosophy as an academic discipline in the sense that we mean it today. And so philosophy in some ways was an imported thing. And so today, when I say China has an identity crisis about philosophy, so, okay, so do you do philosophy in completely the way that West does it, or does it become something slightly different, and then you merge it with this kind of more indigenous tradition conception of philosophy in the way that Confucius or Mencius, etc., understood it?
Okay, thank you. Tongdong, did you have something to respond to?
Not particularly, but just maybe just a quick comment. I guess I share with my colleague Bonobo Manders, pessimism, I think the problem is more. I'm not sure about Europe, but I think more in the West than in China. The problem of listening, I taught in a Jesuit institution in the U.S. for a few years. Xavier University in Cincinnati. And I think on the one hand, I really like the sort of general Catholic understanding of college education. I think the Catholic universities tend to pay more attention to the great books tradition. But still, even in Catholic institutions in the U.S., I think, American students in general, I think they value, in a way, subjectivity in a very bad sense, you know, just a mindless participation. And I remember when I was under my mid-tenure review, another colleague of mine was also under mid-tenure review, and asked him how did he do. One senior professor visited his class. He said it was a good class because so many students spoke up. So that struck me, you know, just students speaking up is the most important sign that the class is good. But sometimes I think students are just, shooting breaks, right? They just speak whatever that comes to them without thinking clearly what they have been about the ideas. And oftentimes we have this perception that Chinese are very obedient, they follow authority, they don't speak up. The Americans, they're very into critical thinking. But to me, really the kind of critical thinking we often encounter in American college classrooms is not critical at all. Although my own experience, Chinese students are more silent in class, it doesn't mean they don't think. oftentimes they want to formulate their questions before they can ask them. So they want to ask, you know, a smart question, not a stupid question. So to me, maybe in terms of humanities education, Chinese students should be encouraged to speak up more, you know, because, you know, if you try to ask a smart question, maybe the time has passed. You don't have the opportunity to ask any questions, to really engage in a conversation. On the other hand, I think, you know, American students maybe should think more before they open their mouth. So I guess, you know, that's my own perception. So maybe they're more, you know, self-righteous and, you know, highly self-regarded student in Benoit's class than in my class. So my experience, I think most students are still on the quiet side, on the listening side, sometimes to their own detriment, I would say.
Okay, thank you for your provocation. I mean, for your comment. And let's have a question or comment by Catherine, please.
Yeah, well, I'm absolutely certain that I should think more before I open my mouth, but I'm going to open my mouth anyhow. So one of the issues that's come up now is this issue of empathy, right? And in the US, there's quite a bit of talk about the humanities, the value of the humanities for creating or inculcating empathy in students. Right, and there's even some neuroscience, some MRI supposed evidence for this. I guess my thought about it has been that if the humanities and the study of the humanities inculcated empathy, then humanities departments would be, of course, the most empathetic and understanding places in the world, which I think we all know isn't necessarily the case. People who study the humanities are humans, you know, as everyone is, and they have the same faults and issues that other humans have. But I have wondered if working harder to articulate that as a value, as we do, you know, we teach reading, we teach foreign languages, we teach the classics, we teach philosophers, might help with that issue. So those are some of the thoughts that the speakers have kind of brought to the forefront in my mind.
Thank you. Did Benoit want to add something?
Sure, very shortly, just for saying that I think Bai Tongdong and I share actually the same experience and are in agreement. I have been a bit provocative, not for speaking about China, but for speaking about humanistic education in general, for stressing the fact that it's not about the curriculum, but about an inspiration. That humanistic education is about the art of letting oneself being transformed. And that students learn that when they see their teacher themselves ready to be transformed by the other. And in the West, as in China, for different reasons, we are meeting with difficulties that makes humanistic education often more formal, I would say, than substantial. I mean, not going towards this goal. And I think we would all agree in different ways around such objective and analysis of the present situation.
Okay, thank you. That's very helpful. I guess, I mean, probably it's both, right? I mean, on the one hand, humanities involves learning about our great intellectual heritage in different traditions, but also it involves some sort of moral transformation, right? It's not only moral transformation. I mean, you can get that through other mechanisms. You know, there might be a drug that it leads to sudden illumination, but that's not what we mean by humanities education, right? So, but my question about this moral transformation part, what about the political component? I mean, let's say a little bit in our remaining time, since we do live in a country that has a problem with censorship and, you know, a certain extent, how does that interfere? Maybe how might it even help with our task of promoting better people and moral transformation? Who wants to try to engage with that question?
It seems that our silence says something on that.
I mean, okay, Shu Chen, do you think that it really, that the overall political environment helps or hinders the teaching of the humanities in China?
I think that this, like, I just speak very frankly, my own honest sort of perception is that there's overt, obviously in any society, there'll be overt kinds of control, but then there's also unovert kind of peer pressure kinds of control as well. So I think that, sometimes when there's a lot of kind of sheeple, like kind of crowd mentality, that ends up being a kind of, that ends up being quite a stifling as well. And I don't know if that makes any.
Sure. What about Benoit and Tongdong? Do you want to have anything to say on that question?
I think that older professors like Tongdong and I don't meet much problem with teaching, okay? That might not be the case with younger teachers. We're obviously meeting a problem, and what I say is very objective, with publication now. Though the problem is, will we be able to build up a corpus of works that will help us to continue this task? China has been wonderful for publishing a lot of works going towards humanistic values, let's say between 1980 and 5 years ago, more or less. This has been slowing down very much. Though for how long, that remains a question. But I'd like to know what Tongdong thinks about it.
I think just to answer this question fully might mean that my teaching career in China will come to an end pretty quickly.
You have limited time anyway, so please speak quick.
I think in the past few years, quite a few college professors have lost their job because what they have said in class is being reported, and then they're being punished directly for what they have said, I think in the past few years. So I wouldn't even say teaching is safe anymore. And a lot of professors, you know, start self-censoring what they're saying. You might get into trouble for all sorts of reasons, then one rational strategy is to say nothing. And my own response is that, if I say nothing, why do I want to become college professor? So then I'll just say whatever I have to say, then, you know, leave the rest to fate. But I think, there is a huge political pressure. And I think in the case of publication, it's even worse. So we're talking about this sort of revival of humanities education, both in Western and Chinese, but a lot of things cannot be published anymore. And I think that's a big issue. You know, we're trying to search for a new identity for China, but if you cannot discuss anything, another example, there's this, One Belt, One Road initiative, but a lot of discussions about, say, Islamic religion, situation in Syria, even the history of Israel, cannot be published in China. How could you have a sensible policy on that? I think that's a big challenge.
Okay, thank you. I mean, it's worth noting that. I agree more with Benoit that the teaching generally is much more free than what people might think on the outside, and that most of the constraints come, and we should be specific here, publishing in Chinese. I think it's still possible to publish more critical works in English and other languages, although of course that's not great for most Chinese philosophers, right? Or people working in the humanities. And also the some areas that were at one time kind of off limits, like the debates in the Confucian tradition are now quite still wide open. Fortunately, there's no one orthodox view of what Confucianism is that we all have to adhere to. But anyway, I agree with what has been said so far. Let's move on to the,
Daniel. Two quick comments. You know, first
one comment, please.
There's this sort of so-called mainland New Confucianism movement. I'm part of that movement, but actually a lot of the discussions are censored, and actually some of the people in the movement are even being punished. So I think you can also get into trouble when you promote Confucianism in China as well.
Yeah. Okay, fair enough. Okay, let's move on to the questions from the audience, please. We have the first one here. How much truth is the statement that the study of humanities and particularly Western classics in China is based on the desire to identify and use the strengths of Western culture as a part of China's rise as a great power? Who wants to pick up that question among the panelists?
I would say the following. Somehow it is historically true, but it doesn't reflect the present reality. I would say that the study of Western classics has become a field by itself with its autonomy, and that nobody thinks that it is by studying Hegel or Thomas Aquinas or whatever that you are going to make China stronger today. The good news, and I think the most important thing, is that in China, comparative classics are developing. So it makes sense now, and we have methodology for speaking about Thomas Aquinas and Zhu Xi together with tools and questions that indeed help us to speak of the two at the same time.
Okay, thank you. Next question for Professor Xiang. Isn't such a complex curriculum rather confusing for students?
I don't know, because I haven't spoken, they haven't told me about this specifically, so I don't have to like say from my own perspective. I think that the PKE students they're quite brilliant. I think that, so I hope that they can handle it. That's just from my perspective. I've never spoken to them before about whether it's confusing, but I think the workload is quite a lot. They're always going from class to class, so that they maybe don't have enough time to go into any one thing in enough detail. That, you know, I've heard that from them before.
I totally agree with that. One of the things that interferes with, we can call it deep thinking or empathetic thinking or whatever, is just the workload they have. I mean, they have sometimes 7 classes per semester. It really affects the ability to go in depth in any one class.
No, the seven classes a semester is a very light load for undergraduate students. Right. Oftentimes they have 15, you know, that's the normal load. That's something that actually puzzles me. You know, when I was an undergraduate student, you know, a lot of my courses, of course I was in, science, nuclear physics major, but still, you know, I took courses in philosophy, you know, sometimes it's a 4-hour per week class, but now, you know, a lot of classes are 2-credit, you know, each. So I think that explains why students have to take so many courses now, because, you know, each course has less credits. How did that happen? I don't know. I'm giving different explanations. Actually, one explanation is the fact that there are so many faculty members in the philosophy department. For them to have enough courses to teach, you have to have a course with less credits. That's one explanation. Another issue, I think, for China, I'm not sure about the West, is that the Chinese university system is, you have to finish certain number of credits. But even if you do that, you cannot graduate. You know, you have to go through the 4-year education. And so a lot of students finish all their courses in the first 2 years. And then the next 2 years, they go out and find, you know, intern jobs. So I think that's another issue. So I've been, you know, asking the university to put a cap on how many credits, you know, each student can take. You know, so I think that also explains why students take so many courses each semester.
There might be a political motivation too, that they're so busy with academic work that they don't have time for extracurricular / political stuff. But anyway, let's have another question here. Are humanities and philosophy subjects studied in high school level in China? Indeed, it is important to insert philosophy to high school as part of the personality development at the same level, in just the same way that it's important to study science in high school. So those of you who have gone through, I know Tongdong maybe, who've gone through the high school here in China, are humanities and philosophy subjects studied in high school in China?
So there's a course called politics, which is really ideology course. And all high school students today are still required to take ideology courses. And those courses are sometimes called 哲学 philosophy. And that is the reason why, you know, among new students, freshmen in the college, I think, you know, literature department and history department, I think they tend to attract more serious students than philosophy departments, because high school graduates, they think philosophy means ideology. And history and literature, they know what they mean. So they, you know, among humanities students, actually, you know, we have to try very hard to show students philosophy is something different from what they have received in high school. However, on the other hand, compared to the kind of high school education I got when I was young, my son just finished high school a year ago. And now actually some high schools have, you know, kind of extracurricular lectures, courses on Chinese classics. So it's not in the official required curriculum, but I think now many high schools offer, more kind of general education, liberal arts education things to high school students. I think that's an encouraging sign of change.
Yes, and if I may add a word, some selective high schools now offer some courses on theory of knowledge and on critical thinking. So that's a limited trend, but quite an interesting one, because that kind of high schools often leads the way towards a change. So I think there is more space than before for shaping, thinking in high school education, but really at an elite level for the time being.
Maybe we can mention that the national examination, Gaokao, has a bit more what we might call philosophy than there used to be. I teach a course on Xunzi at Shandong University, and we began with the first chapter, and I had all studied it for the Gaokao, in fact, memorized it, which actually made the study of that chapter much easier, because we didn't have to spend as much time thinking, you know, understanding it. We can go right away into critical evaluation. I don't know how, so perhaps now the national examination has more philosophy than in the past. Another question, if I may, from the audience. Thank you, Catherine, for helping to select these. Is an ethic or even religious foundation essential for any philosophical approach? I mean, is empathy a basis for any actual confrontation among philosophers, as among ancient, traditional, and modern philosophical systems? Maybe that's for Benoit.
Could you say it again, please? I missed the end of the question. It was a bit quick.
Let's put it this way. Is a religious foundation essential for any philosophical approach? Why don't you answer that?
In general, I would say that indeed religions is at the origin of many systems, and having a good culture in religious studies helps you in aesthetic, in Western philosophy, in Chinese philosophy, because it's hard to separate at the start Chinese philosophy from Chinese religions and so on and so on. But at some point, indeed, religious studies become an independent field as philosophy or aesthetic and so on become one. Though there is a sense of deepening one sense of the way knowledge and different fields of knowledge have been shaped in history, and that requires both to understand the religious roots of them and the way knowledge has become independent from religion. That's a bit short, but that's really a difficult question, I would say.
Okay, thank you. We have another question here. As we know, there's formal censorship in China, but there's a kind of also some sort of informal constraints on freedom of speech in the US. So a question here, I'd be interested in comments about the difference between pressure on free speech in China and in the US. Does anybody want to take that question?
Yeah, actually, that's the other comment I didn't have time to mention during the panelist discussion part. So in spite of what I said about, you know, the I would say increasingly disappointing atmosphere in China, I think in the West, especially in the US, there's this growing so-called cancel culture, and a lot of professors get into trouble for what I see as really insignificant or just pure misunderstandings, you know. I thought it was a joke, but it turns out to be true. You know, a professor at the University of Southern California, he tried to speak a Chinese word that sounded a little bit like the N word in English. Then he was suspended from teaching. You know, how could that be the case? You know, it just drives me crazy. So I think there is a difference. You know, I still would rather live in a liberal society with cancel culture than in the society with just, you know, very specific censorship. But still, you know, what is this difference? Even if we have a liberal society, how can we prevent it from becoming, liberal or tolerant in name only? I think that's really a serious issue, but so I really don't have an answer. I totally share with us the sentiment of the question. So just that's my comment.
There's great differences between the kinds of censorship between China and the U.S., but this is an obvious thing now. It is very difficult in the U.S. to navigate between the various what's considered appropriate ways of speaking in the classroom and inappropriate ways. And there's a lot of, there are layers of discipline that are triggered when certain things are said. And the example that was given is one of those examples, but there are many others that are perhaps, even more surprising. So without going into detail and outing any of my students for this, it's a difficult terrain to navigate, even for the most sensitive of faculty.
Something on that, Daniel, but which is more for you actually, be it in China or the States or elsewhere, I see the great intuition of the liberal thinkers Mill and Tocqueville was that the tyranny of the majority is really something frightening. So I don't know how you react personally to that. You have been very much involved with this kind of debate. But I think today, in very different forms, being in the West, especially in the US, I have to say, or in China, we are again meeting with that problem. The tyranny of the majority can become frightening.
I think that's right. And John Stuart Mill reminds us that it's not just a question of formal censorship, but it's a question of informal kind of common opinion, which sets constraints on what people say and how free they feel to engage in, to criticize the dominant norms. I think that's, as you say, a huge problem in both China and the US, as well as Canada, where I'm from. We're running out of time, so let me go on to another question. How do you think that collaborative projects such as conferences, digital projects, courses online in the humanities between Chinese and foreign institutions, faculty and students could work well? Are there successful examples that we can point to? I mean, this is very important given that the relations are so bad at the top. I mean, what are some successful examples of collaboration that we could point to? Hopefully this is one of them, but what about others?
Well, Princeton series.
I think let's do a little bit of publicity here. Princeton University Press, I mean, courageously opened an office in China a couple of years ago with the aim of publishing the work, the original and academically important works coming out of China. I mean, I think that's a hugely important project, I think, to facilitate more of this communication between China and the West. Are there other examples?
How about Professor Bai's MA English program in Chinese philosophy? That's been very successful, hasn't it?
I think so. And so, you know, just to promote my own program a little bit, you know, actually Benoit is deeply involved in this program as well. So we try to have students, foreign students who don't speak Chinese yet, or who cannot read Chinese well, so that they can come to China, study Chinese philosophy, English, and improve on their Chinese. And many of them may not end up doing, becoming scholars on Chinese philosophy, going on to get a PhD or things like that. So they might go to different fields. And I always tell my students in the program, foreign students, you know, if you go back to your country, if you are very critical of China, that's okay. But criticize China in an informed manner, you know, slightly better than most of the journalists in New York Times, you know, who I think are deeply biased, I think that it's very important. I think just to have a real dialogue, we need to really immerse ourselves in a different culture. And so just maybe a general comment. So in terms of dialogue, you know, often we have, dialogue, but on a very superficial level. The kind of dialogue I would like to see, I promote in my own, organizational work is, maybe just we can put, experts on Machiavelli, say, and experts on Han Feizi, the Chinese so-called legalist thinker. We have both experts, experts from both sides, and just let them present their own studies and side by side, and then they and the audience can see the connections. So without doing the kind of superficial comparison, if you just present great thinkers from both sides, if we believe in the universality of humanity, I think the most profound thinkers from both from different sides can easily speak to each other if you can just present them in a clear and accessible manner instead of doing some kind of superficial comparison.
Okay, yeah, good.
May I add just a word on that? Actually, I think that the opportunities of cooperation between China and the West have been growing exponentially, and we are a bit awash into it. Seen from China, what I hope to see is development of cooperation with other cultures and territory, Latin America, Africa, and first Asia. I'm still astonished by the total lack of dialogue of any kind between China and India, for instance. For me, the real challenge is here. It's not about the debate between China and the States or China and Europe. China has to open up to the diversity of world culture in its exchange.
I think that's a good point, but let me say something about the Berggruen Institute, which actually has a joint academic venture with Peking University, has hosted a dialogue between thinkers who work on ancient Indian views on international relations and ancient Chinese views on international relations, and what they could learn from each other. And that's coming out in book form. So I agree, it's hugely important. And I think you have some of that, there will be more of it in the future. It's interesting too that the curriculum at Beida has Indian philosophy, right? And Arabic philosophy, right? If I'm not mistaken.
Right. Dedicated professors in those fields.
Right. Okay, I'm afraid we've run out of time. So I just want to thank you all for the very stimulating debates and not debates, but exchanges and comments and thoughts. And hopefully we can have more of this. I mean, this is more of an experiment. And once the world becomes normal again, we can hopefully do this live at some point in the future. Thank you so much. Have a beautiful morning for those of you in the United States. And for those of us here in China, it's time to have a little glass of wine before we go to sleep. So thank you so much. And so hopefully we can all see each other live and as well as meet some audience members who are anonymous. But thank you so much for your wonderful questions. And sorry you couldn't get through all of them due to limited time. So thank you and goodbye.